Welcome everyone. So we will start this webinar. So welcome to this first webinar hosted by Orange Belgium. So just a few quick words on Orange and Orange Belgium. So Orange Belgium is a part of the big group Orange. Orange is a worldwide telecom player nominated in the top 20 of most innovative companies. So Orange has over 8,000 employees who are dedicated to research and innovation, and as such is holding over 6,500 patents in portfolio. Orange has around 50 million IoT cards active around the world, and Orange Belgium is managing 10% of them. For Orange Belgium, innovation is in its DNA, and it's very important for them to be able to grow in the future. For that, we have the support of the group, and this helps us growing. So one of those innovative areas in which we are active now is IoT. So welcome to the webinar, How to Grow Your IoT Idea.
Hello everyone, I'm Peter and I'm heading the IoT operations for Orange Belgium. So my team manages day in, day out, the IoT projects to support, and also, of course, the pre-sales assistance to guide our customers and prospects through their ideas. I have a 24-year background in cellular networks and a big fan of how new technologies help the world to become a better place to live in.
Hello, my name is Chris. I'm an IoT product manager for B2B Belgium. So my passion for IoT started some years ago at home. So I have a rain barrel and I wanted to know how much water was still left in it. So I took an ultrasonic sensor, an Arduino, coupled them together. And via the ultrasonic sensor, I was able to measure the water that was still left in the tank. As such, my passion for IoT grew and has started to grow. I'm an engineer with a background in electronics and telecom.
Right. Okay. So you have an IoT idea and you don't know where to start. Well, based on our own learnings, we will show you how we did it. And we'll use four different solutions to show you how to approach a new idea. Now, this is an interactive session, so you will have the opportunity to ask questions through the chat on the right side of your screen. So Jeroen will be answering that. We'll be sharing these questions with ourselves. The four IoT solutions we'll be talking about, first of all, smart tracking. It's a solution that was entirely developed in-house by Orange. Secondly, smart parking. Here, we went to look for a partner that already had an end-to-end solution, and Orange integrated that into its portfolio. Third is a smart environment solution. And there we started building the IoT solution with an external partner. And the last one is a smart industry, where we really co-created a new solution, a new IoT ecosystem in an industry environment.
So just to allow me to also introduce the third person you see on your screen, and that's this Jeroen Michielsen. So he's our customer value proposition who is specialized in IoT. And sometimes we will refer to him in the duration of the presentation. So he's a mysterious guy who's living in the East. So let's start with the first model. The first model is where we developed a solution in-house, and that is our smart tracking solution. In March 2018, Orange Belgium launched as first operator in Belgium Narrowband IoT. We started here by setting our first step in an exciting IoT journey. What you have to know is that Narrowband IoT and also LTM and other competing or technology in cellular technologies creates a low power wide area network. You can't create any IoT solution without a low power wide area network.
Now, first of all, a few words about this low power wide area network. This was introduced in the GSM standards a couple of years ago, and supported by all big players in the ICT and telco world. So not only Ericsson, the Huawei's, the Intel's, also Vodafone, Orange, and et cetera, are really pushing hard to get these technologies in all over the world. And these new technologies were named Narrowband IoT, NB-IoT, and LTE-M. Now, Narrowband IoT is generally used for static objects, like a parking sensor, as we will see later, while LTE-M offers mobility functionality, mobility features, and is so more suitable for tracking solutions. Now, both technologies have been rolled out in Orange, Belgium, but also throughout the world. And today we're already proud to announce that we have more than 10 roaming agreements in LTE-M available for our customers in Europe, in Asia, but also in North America. Now, what are the key benefits that you should remind in this narrowband IoT and LTE-M? Okay, they penetrate deep indoor. They have a signal that goes a signal strength that is 20 dBs higher than the regular 4G. They are battery friendly because the chipsets used are just very very simplified, so they use less power, and the devices are therefore also able to stay operational for several years. They're low cost devices, again, due to the simplified 4G chipsets. And last but not least, they're highly reliable because narrowband IoT and LTE-M use licensed frequencies, and so they eliminate all radio interference. So your microwave or your baby phone will never interfere with your IoT device communication.
If you might have some questions, I'm going to repeat it. Don't hesitate to use the Q&A button. Don't use the chat button. That's not okay. Just use the Q&A button if you have questions. And then Jeroen, our moderator, he will then pick it up and ask it to us, and then we will reply. So IoT is really a must-have for Orange Belgium. So I am part of the marketing department. And as a marketing department, we have been blown away by the enormous figures and the promises that IoT made. So the market potential for IoT is assumed to be in the billions, trillions. So no question whatsoever that there is something that we need to do. But in a big company like ours, marketing alone cannot just make decisions and then go for it. So you need the support of our other stakeholders in the company. So one of the very important stakeholders are, of course, the finance department. It was really easy to convince them because IoT allows you to optimize your existing processes, so you have your cost gain. And also, and even more important, it allows you to find new sources of income. So every company is always looking all the time for new sources of income, and IoT is one of the most promising ones. And then we all, of course, have our sales department. So our sales department, they are really close to the market, and they were feeling already quite some time the buzz around IoT. So everybody was talking about IoT, but something really strange is everybody was talking about IoT, but only a few customers were really working on it. So it's time for Orange to help the customers to get into IoT.
Yes. Once again, all elements are there to really make sure that IoT lifts off. The narrowband IoT and LTE-M network is there. There are the devices at correct price levels, and there are also sufficient cloud solutions to facilitate the access to the data that these IoT devices are uploading. So where to start, how to start, and what to do? Orange Belgium decided not to go the standard way by making a full market analysis, what is needed, create a detailed business case, have this validated by upper management, et cetera, et cetera. This would take too much time we don't have to conquer a new market, a market that still needs to be created and pushed. That's why Orange Belgium applied the approach as many other smaller companies. So we were agile, we are still are, we learn fast, and we move on and adapt our products as necessary. Now, one of the first products we truly believed in was asset tracking. Hence, it was put on our roadmap in 2019, and the journey started.
So IoT is about data. But the amazing thing about IoT is that, as such, it's not really rocket science. So the data, the things you want to measure, that's done by a sensor that exists already for a lot of time, for a long time. The really new element that has arisen is the cellular low power wide area network connectivity. So the narrowband IoT and LTM. So that's the part that's brand new. So we have our sensors, we have our cellular network, so we can transport the data, but then your data needs to be treated somewhere. And that's also now the right time to treat it because we really see emerging cloud services everywhere. So it's really easy now to get your data somewhere in the cloud available, and you don't need to invest anymore in IoT infrastructure or IT infrastructure. So everybody can reuse on what is existing all over the world.
Yes, it's even better, Chris, because all those building blocks exist today in the Orange product portfolio. So Orange Belgium, in this case for the smart tracking, was not alone. Other countries, other Orange affiliates were also exploring the possibilities of asset tracking, like our friends in France, Spain, and Slovakia. So this was a joint effort from Orange Group. The building blocks that we use are a device from Ercogener. It's a French company that developed the tracking device. We use the Orange IoT management platform called Live Objects, but we'll talk about Live Objects a bit later in this webinar. And of course, Orange also developed the tracking application that they to give the customers a web portal to easily manage their assets and see the data. And of course, Orange assures that all these building blocks work together perfectly. So let's deal with the device first.
Finding the right device is complex, and making it is also very complex because a device, it needs to be highly reliable at an affordable cost. And those two criteria are not easy to combine. So when a hardware developer start to think about an IoT device and how should I make it, he tries, of course, to optimize and tries to find the hardware that will fit most of the use cases. But it's really complicated because the hardware, it must work in a wide variety of environmental conditions. So is the device for inside or is it for outside use? Does it need to be able to resist to shock, dust, humidity, high temperature, low temperature? All of those have a big influence of the quality of your casing, the quality of your electronics, and also, of course, the costing. Another important factor in all this story is the powering. So how are we going to power the device? Can we use it just to plug it in the current, or going to use a battery? And if we use a battery, so if the choice is made, it should be a battery, will we use a rechargeable battery or not? Seems quite easy and say, okay, let's use a rechargeable battery. But unfortunately, the characteristics of a rechargeable battery are not really good. So they really have issues with reliability over time and reliability resistance to high temperature. So we had a use case in which we put a rechargeable battery, but we noticed that when the temperature was too high, that the device simply stopped working. The form factor: do we make a bulky device or does it need to be a small device? Of course, the size of the device matters. So if you have a big device, you can put a big battery, meaning longer lifetime, and at the end it will cost you much less than if you have a small battery and you need to replace the battery all the time. Also, your device is not only hardware, it is firmware included. So most of the hardware developers, they are aware of UDP and TCP, how it works. But we are also starting on working on new technologies. We will make transport available in like kind of SMS style. So that's not UDP, not TCP, it's just really embedded programming. Our network, so our cellular networks based on Narrowband IoT and LTM, they have specific features to optimize their battery. So some of those features are called power save moding, extended DRX. And then together with some network features, network timers, you can really optimize the battery consumption of your device. But that's not easy. It takes a learning time and you have to take that into account. And then last but not least, of course, is the coverage. So your device, it needs to send data. If it does not have any coverage, where will the data go to? So different strategies can be followed there. I'm going to do, for example, if you deploy a device with LTM, and there is no LTM coverage, will you create a device that stores the data in the device and then just will send all the data in bulk when it's get again some coverage, which will make your electronic devices a little more complicated, makes your firmware more complicated? Or are you going to go and provide a fallback mechanism? For example, you don't find LTM coverage, you switch to 2G fallback.
Yeah. So it's really of key importance that you clearly describe the one use case you want to develop, because every other factor depends on that. Our use case, as Chris explained, was to track non-powered assets. So the battery life was very important, was a very important criteria. So we thought initially, okay, let's equip the device with a solar panel. Then it recharges while it's on the road. During summer, this worked very fine. But during the winters, there's just not enough light to recharge the battery sufficiently. So of course, the battery lifetime is depending on the use case. Also, if the tracker sends data more often, like every minute, the battery, of course, will be drained much faster than if the tracker just sends twice per day its location to the backend. Now, Chris, can you explain us a bit more about the tracking application?
One of the major features, of course, from a tracking application is to know what your device is. So that was really important for a customer, is where is my device? So that's what we call the location feature. So the application allows you to see where is my device and also where has it been. Another feature is, but really important one, is the device where it's supposed to be? So that's what we call geofencing. So what geofencing basically does, you define an area, zone 1, 2, 3, or 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, it doesn't matter, in which you want to confine or some assets or some devices. So what happens is that you can then generate alarms if asset enters the area or leaves the area. So this might be useful if you have some business critical assets that you really want to know every time where they are and you need to control. You just create a geofence around these assets. And when it starts moving, you call the guy and say, hey guy, that's not okay. I need that asset tomorrow. It's for me, it's much more useful than for you. So that's the geofencing. Geofencing, as I mentioned, is linked to alarming. So it's not only alarms are not only created using geographical parameters. We can also define or create alarms based on battery parameters. For example, if your battery is going low, an alarm is created and the user is of the end user, the customer is informed that he needs to go and replace the device. Might be quite handy if you put a tracker on the on your assets to know where it is. If you have a lot of devices, it's handy to be able to group them. So we are also able to define and cluster devices using metadata. For example, if you have 10 to 5 assets that need to remain in zone 1, then you call them assets in zone 1, you group them, and then you can trigger your alarms based on this this configuration. If your device is growing and you have a lot of data, you might find it important to use the data and do something else with it. So it's really important to be able to integrate the data that is generated by the sensor into your IT environment. So therefore, their APIs are available to do this. And then again, if you have a lot of devices, and as Peter already mentioned, a device is you can configure a device when it will send this update. So there are different mechanisms available. You can tell the device, okay, you send your updates once a day, twice a day on fixed and on fixed periods of time. If you say, okay guys, you okay asset, okay device, you start sending your information just when you start moving. We learned from our customer that it's not that easy to find the right balance between the configuration of the tracker and the battery consumption. So that's why we have also foreseen a mechanism that allows you to over the air to change the configuration of your assets. And then, of course, again, back to the basic topic of everything is coverage. So therefore, the tracker is basically a tracker which is based on LTM combined with a 2G fallback. Good. So this brings us to the end of our first model. Our first model being in a home development, so an intergroup development of an own solution. So what are now the advantages and the challenges that we have seen in this model? So if you go for in-house development, it means that you will have full control over your product features. If you're part of a big group like Orange, you can capitalize on the different countries and the different affiliates that are going to use it. As Peter explained, so France, Slovakia, Spain, we are all deploying the same solution. Another big advantage is, of course, the quality. It's very important for the end user that they are, for our customers, that they are convinced of the quality. We don't procure devices from Alibaba, and our services are not made in a basement. They are thoroughly tested and by the big company, which is called Orange, and all the affiliates are using it. So we are really profiting, or really making advantage, I think that's a better translation. We're really taking advantage of the testing capabilities and the size of the group. And then, of course, costs, major important thing. If you split the cost of development over different affiliates, you can make a better application and you can use much or create much better features for your customer.
Okay, but we have to say that this is a standard off-the-shelf solution sold in four countries, so making it more difficult, of course, to adapt it to specific customer needs. So it's difficult also to prioritize specific Belgian requirements versus requirements that are also put forward by other countries within the same Orange group. So that has to be kept in mind. Right. Okay, so let's go to the second solution, smart parking. Smart parking, here we went looking for a partner that already had developed a parking solution. And we found one through the Orange FAP program. Orange FAP is the accelerator program of the Orange Group, European wide. And it looks for interesting new startups where Orange tries to scale up these startups, tries to help them get their idea on the market and sold at the end at sufficient numbers. And there will be a dedicated webinar around this innovation and Orange FAP. So keep in mind the following webinar announcements. So in 2018, Orange FAP selected Communitings as a winner of Orange FAP. And together with them, we launched our smart parking solution. So what is the idea of smart parking? In fact, a study showed that car drivers really like to know beforehand if they can park at their destination. The predictability of this is really seen as the biggest advantage by consumers. Of course, smart parking has other advantages for cities because it increases traffic safety, because drivers looking for parking, okay, they pay less attention to the other traffic ongoing. It saves costs because fewer enforcers have to go out to look where people, if people are parked correctly or not. And of course, it also creates less CO2 emission because drivers need less time to find the right parking space. Right. Okay. I think, Chris, you'll be commenting the real case we had in Braine-l'Alleud.
Yeah. So, so basically, how does it work? How does the solution work? How it's built up? So we have the real case of Braine-l'Alleud. So Braine-l'Alleud, they wish to implement a smart parking solution to help the customers guide them to the visitors to the nearest parking place for all the reasons that Peter just explained. One of the major drivers for cities is to, on top of that, of course, of all the CO2 and environmental reasons, is to increase the number of visits to the local merchants, and as such increase, of course, the revenue for the local merchants. So we have some results of that. Is that basically when normally the turnaround is around 3 per day, it has increased till 9 per day. So back to Braine-l'Alleud, or continue with Braine-l'Alleud. So Braine-l'Alleud, they had 6 different parking spots or lots across the city. So we equipped them with camera-based sensors, and which were going to able to tell which parking spot is available and which one is not available. When you look at the parking smart parking ecosystem, you have 3 different kind of users in that ecosystem. The first part in that ecosystem is you and I. So basically, we are the ones that are driving around in our car and trying to find a parking spot. Second party or second stakeholder in the story is the enforcement manager. So the enforcement manager is the guy that needs to make sure that you don't stay too long or that you pay. And the third stakeholder is the parking owner, and he wants to optimize, of course, the use of the available parking spot. So in the solution, those 3 stakeholders have been covered. So we, the end user, we are getting an app, which is, as you can see on the screen, which will guide you to the nearest available parking place. The enforcement manager, he also has an application, and that application will show him which parking spots are almost overdue. So meaning, okay, in 5 minutes, there's still a car, nothing moving, the chances are high that he will go in violation. So once this parking spot, it's not the parking spot itself that goes into violation, but once the car and so the owner of the car goes into violation, they get an alert on their app, they are guided to the parking place which is in violation, and they can ride out a fine. So it's not no more just randomly running around and trying to see where is somebody in violation. No, it's really guided and increases a lot of the efficiency that enforcement managers have. And then the third part or the third stakeholder is the parking owner. And then we provide them with a lot of graphs, information about occupancy rates, statistics to compare the parking occupancy over time between parking zone, and as such, they can optimize its parking management strategy.
Okay, now smart parking is not only interesting for cities, also enterprises, enterprise customers can benefit from it. And one of our recent deployments was at the VRT, so the Flemish radio and television site, where there was a clear demand to optimize parking occupancy for parking spots with recharging facilities for electrical vehicles. So upon their demand, the parking application was, the user application was really optimized, customized, and also branded for VRT specific. Now, the possibilities for companies besides that are really very wide. It helps employees, visitors, patients, clients to find a parking spot easily. There's a possibility to reserve dedicated parking spots, for example, for electrical cars, but also for management or VIP customers. You can optimize the management of your parking spots, and you can even monetize your free parking spots by renting them out to other companies.
So, first model we showed at Smart Tracking was our in-house developed solution. This model is where we went into C, I think this is getting a bad translation, with a partner who had a completely working solution. So the biggest advantage of this, and that goes without saying, is that you start from a finished and working IoT solution that has already proven its value technically and commercially. You build on the partner's knowledge, so you don't have to go to a lot of meetings, to a lot of know-how to be acquired. You start really up to speed, and it's easy to get your internal stakeholders at speed. And then again, you have the agility of a scale-up, which allows for a fast response to our customers' demands.
But this speed of this smaller company, this scale-up, okay, of course, conflicts, as we have seen, with some internal processes of a bigger company like Orange. So really, the processes need to be reviewed once you industrialize this solution.
Good. Let's go to the third model. So that's working together with an external partner who has a part of the solution, but not everything. So in this case, it's the smart environment solution. So maybe you're wondering, and maybe you're probably also confronted with the fact, so how can I improve my day-to-day environment? We all work of the most of us who work in bureaus, or they know that the air quality, for example, is important. So how do you get energized? This is something that is not only at employee level, but also at employers level. The orange group of human resources, the orange human resources group, one of their strategies, of course, is to optimize the well-being. And the well-being of the employees, that's not only at business level, but it's also a society question. Because in 2nd of May 2019, the government issued a royal decree which described that the employer must execute a risk analysis of the air quality. So to be able to do this, the employer has to identify possible sources of pollution to make sure that the quality of the air is okay. So it's a rather long royal decree, but to make a long story short, in fact, the easiest way to do this is to measure the number of CO2 particles in the air and make sure that they are in line with the requirements. So we thought, why not make a product that helps our customers to measure this?
Now, instead of just developing a CO2 measurement solution, we said it would be little effort to add other types of measurements to this same solution, like measuring temperature, the humidity, the air pressure, because all these combined could render more benefits. Now, we decided not to go for the fully fledged operational model with all use cases nicely written out, trained and implemented. We just wanted to get quick feedback on what the customer really needs. So we started launching a new product, which is easy to use for the customer. It works in plug and play mode, so you can easily deploy it. And therefore, we look for a partner that was really able to start small, but could really guarantee large volume commitments if necessary. A partner that was flexible, but that also took all hardware logistics on his account, especially in the beginning, and who had the experience in building applications in a flexible and modular way, so that it was easy to change the product along the way. So we found such a local partner close to, by the way, Jeroen's place in the far east of Belgium. But unfortunately, we cannot disclose the name at the partner at this stage.
So to come back to the flexibility, we created together with our partner a starter pack. And this starter pack was based on Narrowband IoT technology. So the idea of the starter pack is you get a pre-configured box, which includes connectivity, an application, and the necessary devices. So we developed it, as Peter said, in different flavors to cover the different use cases. So one box to measure the temperature inside and outside the building, one box to measure the humidity, and one box to measure the CO2 quality. So we made the ordering as simple as ordering a pizza, and the using should be as simple as using an Apple device.
Yes, this starter pack is of course a standard solution, but I repeat myself, okay, what we really wanted is to learn what the customer really needs and adapt accordingly and as quickly as possible. So this requires flexibility in hardware and software, and being flexible in devices is difficult. And so far we didn't find a good way to offer this. So we started from a device that was there. So the flexibility had to be in the application, and that is now built in by default. Okay, the application has for the moment temperature graphs, alarms when the temperature is too high, too low. But we could imagine that we start grouping more of the measurements together, like I said, CO2, temperature, humidity, and then according to results, okay, have some logic built in to make to do some actions afterwards. So we could imagine to create, for example, a correlation between the air quality measured in the building and the amount of sick people in that same building. The possibilities are really infinite, so it's really up to your particular use case.
Good. We are back to the conclusion. So first was an internal developed solution. Second was taking the solution that exists from the market. And now this third model is with an external partner to build an end-to-end solution. So what again are the advantages and the challenges? So the advantages is here is that you get an optimal mix between the flexibility of the partner and the industrialization nature of a big company like Orange. So that's really something very important. In this case, you also have full control of the roadmap, and you can easily blend this with the experience and the capabilities of your partner. Again, you have a quick start. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. Everything exists already at the partner side. It's also for your internal stakeholders, it's much easier to convince them to participate if they know it already exists, that there are a few development costs to be done, and that's basically no risk to start in this way. And with this particular approach, we can really tailor quickly.
Yes. Of course, Orange is supporting this solution and has to be able in its working methods, in its internal support processes, it has to be able to follow the flexibility of a partner. So the product might change in a couple of weeks. And then the support, of course, needs to be briefed, trained accordingly. It also requires larger testing capabilities to transform this this first quick solution into a fully industrialized solution. So this is to be taken care of course. Right. Okay, in the last use case, smart industry, we'll be explaining how we build a new ecosystem for a large industry partner. For many enterprises, it's very complex to introduce digital transformation, especially in the legacy infrastructure, especially if it concerns then a manufacturing process. So putting all the necessary IoT building blocks together is not an easy job and requires expertise in various different domains. There's not only the network, there's also the devices, there's the cloud solutions and the full IT integration. And this all together needs to work smoothly, of course. Hence why we will explain this use case, which all started using Orange Rapid Development Kit. Okay. It started early last year when a large manufacturing company in Antwerp aimed at exploring IoT technology. They really wanted to see what IoT technology could mean for their manufacturing efficiency. Now, for confidentiality reasons, we cannot disclose the name of the company, so we'll just be calling them the company.
So the company, they heard of our new low-power wide area network access technologies, Narrowband IoT and LTM. So they read the specs, they understood it. But what is really difficult for them to capture is, what can it bring? What does it bring for me? What are the possible enhancements I can do in my day-to-day business? So to help them with that, we proposed them the Rapid Development Kit. So what is this famous Rapid Development Kit? So this Rapid Development Kit is basically a combination of the hardware you need, repackaged, with the connectivity, such as Narrowband IoT LTM, and then also your cloud environment, which allows you to gather and to use your data efficiently. So how does it work? Basically, as also shown in the small video, is that in the box, you take the sensor you need for your experiment. So basically, to help the customer, we have foreseen three different experiments. So if, for example, you have an environmental question, you connect the temperature sensor to the Arduino. You connect your modem. You put in your SIM card. You download the firmware. You put it on. And poof, you're connected to your cloud environment. So in less than 30 minutes, or let's say 30 minutes, you have an idea of how this technology works, Narrowband IoT or LTM. So you take your device, you put it somewhere, you start measuring, and it's not about big, and you don't need to be a really technical experiment. It's really made from a business point of view.
Yes. Now, the company we are talking about, okay, they played around for several months with the kit. They tried out different sensors, different use cases. But then they came to us and they said, okay, we want Orange to work out with us an end-to-end proof of concept for a specific use case. Okay, the use case is illustrated high level in the picture you see. And the main objective was to constantly monitor air pressure at the in and the outlet of a compressor, and then to trigger manual intervention if pressure difference was surpassing thresholds. Now, the company expected that all sensor data would be collected and transferred into their already existing business applications running on a Microsoft Azure cloud environment. So we'll be walking now through the setup. First setup, again, was to look for an appropriate device, complying, of course, with the specific requirements of pressure management. Now, today, a pressure measurement sensor is not existing, not compliant with narrowband IoT. So we had to find a partner to build such prototype. And again, we found one close to Jeroen's natural habitat. So the partner started developing a tailor-made prototype, including a narrowband IoT chipset, which you see here in the picture. It integrates, in fact, the pressure sensor that was supplied by the company because it was very industry specific. So, but our partner combined this sensor with a narrowband IoT chipset and developed this device in less than 4 weeks. It then got installed at the company's manufacturing environment, as illustrated also in the picture on the right side.
Good. So the next step is you got your prototype connected, and then it needs to transport this data. So the device itself, so the prototype device, transported data using Narrowband IoT and uBlox chipsets. So it's a really ultra-efficient way of sending data, because Narrowband IoT is basically a stripped-down version of 4G. It's specifically developed for simple and low-cost devices. Take care. At this period of time, battery lifetime was not looked at yet. It's just a prototype. So as you see here, you see also the word MQTT, and this is the protocol that was used to transport the data from the device to the cloud environment.
Yeah, maybe Chris, a few words extra on MQTT. What is that exactly?
Okay, so MQTT is a network protocol. It exists already a long time, and it's based on a publisher listener subscription model. It's really bandwidth efficient, and it uses little energy, and it's built on top of TCP/IP normally. So how does it work? For example, we have here our humidity sensor, and it publishes to your central broker unit, which is MQTT broker. So it puts it there. And then you have your your application that will consume this information. You can use on-premise analytics or cloud analytics. And those analytics applications, they have to subscribe. So they have to say, if this device or other devices publish something concerning humidity, I want to be informed. So it's quite simple. This humidity sensor publishes 32%. This application, they have subscribed to this information, and then it will be published by the broker onto the analytics information.
Okay, this MQTT broker is part of the IoT gateway. We spoke about IoT gateway in the beginning of our presentation. So Orange developed its own IoT gateway called Live Objects. And Live Objects, okay, it allows you to manage your devices, but also the data sent by the devices in a structured way, because your devices will be sending thousands, 10,000s, millions of messages, all coming together in this IoT gateway. And what you need as a customer is an easy access to these devices, or to at least the data of these devices. Now, Live Objects supports more than MQTT. It also supports other protocols like CoAP, the lightweight machine-to-machine protocol, HTTP, and even messages sent by SMS. Live Objects also contains other logic to manage data management rules, It can also help to manage the firmware update of all your devices. And it can also potentially enrich the data coming from the devices by tagging other parameters before sending it up to your data center. So let's show what live objects offered in the use case we worked out for the company that we're discussing here.
Good. So live objects, basically, so the use case for the customer was to know is the difference between the air before and after the pressure sensor. So what is the difference in pressure for the air filter before and after the outlet? So what we did to help them is we created a simple dashboard, which you see here. So live object allows for the simple creation of dashboards. And you see this is a really rather boring graph because it just shows you that there is no pressure difference. So this is really fine. So this is excellent, top. So what is really interesting, of course, is the fact that you can link rules to deviations in this graph. For example, you can define a rule that if the difference is too high, that you can send an alarm to somebody who needs to know this alarm. Or you can also create rules that say, okay, there is no information coming anymore from the sensor, so it alerts somebody. So that's what we showed to you. Yeah, the data is now in live objects. Now we want to transform it further and integrate it in the customer's Microsoft Azure Cloud environment. So data, it's all fine, but at the end, it needs to come into the customer's environment so that they're able to integrate it into their larger system. In this case, the company was using Microsoft Azure. So we developed a connector between LiveObject and Microsoft Azure. It's written in C# that allows the transport of the data that are now residing in the LiveObject IoT platform, that they are transported to Microsoft Azure. It was a quite simple development. It only took 2 to 3 days. And again, we benefit from the fact that we are part of a big group because the Orange Poland developers had already experienced with this, so it went quite well. So once your data is into your customer IT environment, you can not only just integrate it in your IT, the real added value comes when you are able to create new business streams, new revenues, optimize your processes. So therefore, Orange Belgium, or Orange, is also bought Business and Decision, and they are really specialized in analyzing your data. So those are the guys that if you have a lot of data and you want to optimize your processes or look for new revenue streams, you have to go with those guys, and they will help you, and or we will help you to get the most of the data out of it. At the moment, we have trialing this end-to-end setup with the company for a couple of months now, and we help the customer better understand and better manages his production process.
Yeah, this use case has really shown us that Orange is really pushing very hard to do co-creation, to apply the co-creation approach, and to jointly turn, in fact, the IoT potential into a reality and a commercial success for us, while it benefits for the enterprise. We've also been able to prove the strength of Orange being an international company, an international group with expertise spread all over. And we also go further than just purely wireless connectivity or wireless network knowledge. So Orange selects the right devices, it integrates your data flows into your existing environment, and it even assists enterprises in taking the right business decisions.
So advantages, challenges. Advantages really is a hands-on approach. Instead of sending slides to the customer, you give him something they can work on. So that's the rapid development kit. Once the customer understands the benefits they can have with the concept of IoT, you help them in going into something that's more dedicated for their kind of business. So that you help them developing a POC device. And then when that is done, the next step, of course, is that the data that is generated, it needs to go somewhere. And then we also help in integration with the Azure Cloud. It's co-creation, we all learn.
Yeah. Of course, the biggest challenge is or will be the scalability. How do we go now from this prototype devices and these proof of concepts into a wide-scale sensors deployment? So how to assure that this prototype will allow us also to confirm the promises of excellent battery lifetime, the industrial reliability, and keeping it all at reasonable price levels. So this was the end of the fourth use case. Question to Jeroen. Jeroen, was everything super clear? And did you get some questions for us? I see four questions. Okay, shoot. So Jeroen is probably typing up a first question.
Maybe it's easy, Jeroen, if you just unmute and ask us.
Ah, how long do NB-IoT and LTM sensors live? What is the lifetime?
This is all depends on, I think we have one very good use case. So this is smart tracking, which we have experience, is that it all depends on how you configure it. So for the, it's all optimized. So to have to go as far as you want and as long as you want, but amount of times that you will send data is really important. So for the smart tracker we have, it's LTM, it's GPS based. So GPS is really, as you know, it's really battery if you send an information, it will take you 5 years. So to consume the, to drain the battery. However, if you start sending every 10 minutes something as information, well, then you will have problems lasting some months. So it's all, and that's not the only thing. You also have to take into account where you are, especially when there's a GPS, the time it needs to find the lock or that to lock to into the satellites, that's also important. And having coverage or not is also important. So it really depends on the use case and how you have parameterized your device.
Yeah. And of course, Orange can support you in finding the right device. I think we've shown a few cases here today where we really went to look based on the requirements of the customer to look out for partners that can develop not only the prototype, but can even supply in big amounts, in big volumes, the necessary devices. It's always a combination in finding the right device for the application, and then also combine it with the right access technology as narrowband IoT and LTM. And that's often the most difficult part. Maybe next question, Chris, is rather for you. So what differentiates our smart tracking solution compared to other tracking solutions on the market?
Well, I think the most important differentiator is that we are managing it end to end. So we are managing the device, we are managing the network, and it's our network, it's a cellular network, so you have coverage. We as a group have roaming agreements everywhere, we can deploy it in all countries. We have control over the IoT platform, and we also have control over the application. And as such, we can guarantee, in fact, the combination of quality with the network and the assurance that you have a big company and a big operator behind the solution.
Then there's a question about LoRa devices. So I have LoRa devices that I want to combine with narrowband IoT devices and manage them all together in one data platform. That is, of course, one of the key objectives of that IoT gateway. So the IoT gateway is in fact not considering the type of access technology used. So if the data is coming from devices, from LoRa devices or narrowband IoT devices, whatever, as long as the transport protocol is understood by live objects, by the IoT gateway, it can capture any data before sending it further on to your network. So it makes abstraction, in fact, of the access technology. And that's, so you do need, of course, in the case presented, if you have LoRa devices, narrowband IoT devices, of course, somehow you need an IoT gateway to collect information from both type of devices and then send it further to your IT backend. Then I see a question on 5G. Okay, will I have to adapt my narrowband IT devices to support the new frequencies? Now, 5G, of course, is operating on on different frequencies very often. And yes, the chipsets in your narrowband IoT device that is manufactured today is probably containing a chipset that does not support these 5G frequencies yet. So in time, we will see chipsets coming onto the market that support both 4G and 5G frequencies. But today, this is not the case. Now, narrowband IoT, let's not forget, narrowband IoT is basically for devices that are relatively static or completely static and that do not send much information. So the there's no need today to have 5G in order for your low power IoT devices to work. So the narrowband IoT on 4G is more than enough. And in later releases of the 5G specs, it is foreseen to incorporate this narrowband IoT and LTM technologies. Hope this is sufficient. Otherwise, I see that we're close to 12 o'clock, so we should perhaps close.
So if this is it the end? So basically, we wanted to show you with these four cases that the possibilities to develop IoT solutions are really infinite, that there are different methodologies, all have their advantages and challenges. So here at Orange Belgium, as you see, we tried them all. So we acquired quite some IoT know-how. And that's why we are happy to propose for those interested to grow their ideas to come and grow them with us.
Yes, and that's where we have a gift for you. So what Orange offers is 2 hours of dedicated coaching around your IoT idea. So how to describe? You send a mail to the email address from your room indicated here, and we will get back to you and we come along and discuss with you for 2 hours around your IoT idea.
Voilà. We hope you enjoyed our first webinar of many, many, many to come. So the next webinar will be around fixed connectivity. We're coming with it very soon. So thanks for following our first one. So goodbye and thank you.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.